In 1865, Charles Darwin published his famous book on the origin of species. And to end it, he said, "From so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved." Darwin was talking about evolution here, but this also applies to research in evolution, and especially human evolution. His book was the so simple beginning to the endless forms of beautiful and wonderful thoughts on how human evolution works. These thoughts have changed a lot over time, just like you and I have. And although we've made mistakes in the past, that's okay, because we've learned from our mistakes to discover more about human evolution and ourselves, and to hopefully open up to changing again in the future. So come along with me on this journey through time as we see how, just like us, human evolutionary thoughts have been and are being evolved. In 1898, Theodor Eimer, a German zoologist, introduced the idea of orthogenesis, aka direct evolution. This was a biological hypothesis that organisms have an innate tendency to evolve in a definite direction towards some goal due to some internal mechanism or driving force. Supporters of this line of thought disagreed with Darwin's claim that natural selection was the major driver of evolution, that it couldn't be responsible for the vast variation we see in nature. Rather, they argued that there was instead an intrinsic perfecting principle that drove every organism to be a perfect specimen. This hypothesis was partly based on the discoveries of hominin fossils and their progression from simple primates to the perfect human being. We now know that orthogenesis is wrong, but this is how a lot of researchers thought evolution worked, and it shaped not only science's view of human evolution, but also the public's. This happened most notably with the famous picture, The March of Progress. And if you want to learn more about how, I made a whole other episode about it, right here. But this is all okay, because researchers were discovering more about human evolution, and in the 1940s, realized they needed to change their way of thinking. Gregor Mendel was an Austrian monk in the 1860s, and is credited as the father of modern genetics for discovering Mendelian genetics, which is a specific type of inheritance that describes how traits are passed down from parent to offspring. And when researchers were looking back on both Darwin and Mendel's work, many thought Darwin's theory of evolution and Mendel's laws of genetics were actually opposing theories due to their differences in timescales. Darwinian evolution taking millions of years, and Mendelian genetics taking only a few generations. But in 1942, Julian Huxley, a British evolutionary biologist, published a book revealing his hypothesis on how evolution works, Evolution, the Modern Synthesis. It combines Charles Darwin's theory of evolution and Mendelian genetics to suggest that evolution occurs by natural selection acting on genes passed down over time. This means that when the environment changes, natural selection favors genes that have a better chance of keeping an organism alive and reproducing. Organisms that don't have those genes die, and organisms that do live on and evolve over time. Supporting Mendel's genetic experiments and Darwin's evolutionary tree that we all know today. This hypothesis was revolutionary not only for its discovery, but also because it took all that we had learned, both our triumphs and our mistakes, and pushed evolution into modern science. And afterwards, like us, researchers learned a lot more and evolved to have endless thoughts, most beautiful and wonderful. Ernst Mayr, a German evolutionary biologist, put forth the biological species concept, which suggests a species is a group of populations capable of reproducing viable and fertile offspring together. And Theodosius Dziobzhansky, a Ukrainian-American evolutionary geneticist, put forth genetically how new species emerge, which states isolated populations over time become genetically different, and thus different species. But even with all these forms of the modern synthesis, researchers were discovering even more about evolution. And by the late 1990s, slowly realized they needed to change their way of thinking again. Human evolutionary researchers felt that once species diverged on the evolutionary tree, they could no longer interbreed with each other because of the biological species concept mentioned earlier, which says that a species is a group of populations capable of reproducing viable and fertile offspring together. But in the late 1990s, Wu Xinzi, a Chinese paleoanthropologist, proposed his hypothesis for how human evolution works. The braided stream. It states that the evolutionary tree model and the biological species concept don't correctly portray human evolution, and suggests that when hominid species diverge, they not only live together, but also interbred with each other over time. This means that hominid populations would temporarily become isolated, develop unique traits and into new species, rejoin in the same area, and then interbreed, sharing their genes together. Just like how a braided stream forms in nature, with its small offshoots that come back to the main stream. And just like how we form in our lives, by discovering new parts of ourselves, then integrating them into who we are. This hypothesis was originally based on mosaic morphology of hominid fossils in China, and more recently has been supported with ancient DNA analyses. These diverging and interbreeding hominid species had both unique and shared characteristics, making it hard to distinguish them from one another by just using an evolutionary tree. While researchers now know that the braided stream is a better representation of human evolution, the public isn't as aware of this. Most people still think of Darwin's evolutionary tree when thinking of human evolution. And some even still think of the march of progress. But this isn't the end of our journey. From so simple beginnings to what we know now, we can ask what new human evolutionary thoughts will evolve next. That's where we come in. Our interests will fuel the discoveries that change our understanding of human evolution. And most importantly, allow us to be open to evolving not only our thoughts, but ourselves. Everything has been and is still evolving. Whether it's nature, human evolutionary thoughts, or you. We get things wrong. We learn from our mistakes. And we hopefully open up to the possibility of changing again. It can be hard to navigate this endless cycle. But hopefully, by learning about the journey of human evolutionary thoughts, alongside your personal journey of self-discovery, you can better understand that we will always get things wrong. But like Darwin said, from so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved.